You may not know her name, but her work graces the walls of the most prestigious museums in the world. She was the first woman in history to make a living from painting. And she was at the center of a salacious scandal that rocked Renaissance Rome. A woman's life in the 17th century was not an easy one. Most accepted their lot. Artemisia Gentileschi did not. With only her talent to sustain her, she flew in the face of almost every assumption about women current in the culture of late Renaissance Italy. And she did it all without money and education, and despite the obstruction of the men in her life.
I think she's become an inspiration because of what she achieved. And she had so many things stacked against her in her early life.
Artemisia Gentileschi made her declaration of independence in a courtroom in Rome in 1612.
Artemisia Gentileschi, siete qui convocata davanti a questo sacro tribunale per rendere testimonianza nel processo contro Agostino Tassi.
She was 19 years old, barely literate and openly defying convention. Her court case caused a scandal and was to entirely change the direction of her life, helping to make her the artist she became. It was the first of many occasions when Artemisia was to take her destiny into her own hands.
Artemisia did what she wanted, painted what she wanted. She boasted that she painted for all the most important princes of Europe. And it was true. The King of England courted her to get her to come to London. She painted for the Queen of France, Maria de' Medici, and of course, for the King of Spain.
She was a great lady, a very great lady, with a phenomenal energy, a curiosity, and talent. I mean, a really great artist.
Artemisia Gentileschi was the daughter and the pupil of Orazio Gentileschi, a widowed father of four, and at the time one of Italy's most famous painters.
He seemed to train her very much in the same way that any other workshop assistant would have been taught. Everyone in the family seems to have recognized right away that she was really the talented one and the heir to Orazio's talent, and in fact, surpassed him. So.
Orazio's goal in training her was never to build her a career. He wants her to serve him. That was usual for a painter's workshop. It also colored their father-daughter relationship.
Caravaggio è un pittore eccezionale, come non ce ne sono altri su questa.
Orazio passed on techniques learned from his friend Caravaggio. But the rest of Artemisia's training was somewhat basic. The popular view was that women needed to be taught only what was strictly necessary. And Orazio certainly saw no need to have an educated daughter.
As a woman artist in Italy, she had distinct limitations because women were not expected to go through the ordinary channels of art education. So she didn't have access, for example, to studio practice, which involved painting or drawing from nude figures.
Orazio considered it his duty to keep his daughter close to his side. He wasn't alone. This was a time when young women were thought to be inherently vulnerable, in need of constant supervision.
The life of the street was quite dangerous and unpredictable. And so for young women in Rome, of any class of society, it was important to be indoors.
Artemisia, figlia mia, ancora una volta la finestra.
Artemisia was always chaperoned. A girl's virginity was then of primary importance, a matter of honor for both her and her family. A single father, Orazio would have preferred to see his daughter safely in a convent.
He resisted this idea of joining the convent. Her father had to recognize her talent and really encourage her as a painter.
Orazio took Artemisia around the city to visit churches. That was the art world. That was like the Museum of Modern Art.
Barely educated and trained only to become her father's model and assistant, Artemisia nevertheless began to develop her own unique style.
To paint in a way that women of the time weren't. She's not doing pretty little flowers or puppies or devout paintings of the Madonna. She's doing ambitious, large-scale, historical and biblical subjects.
I think that it is Artemisia who transformed herself into a historical painter. She badly wanted to become one, and in one way or the other, she convinced her father.
This is one of her first known paintings. It tells a story drawn from the Bible. Beautiful Susanna is accosted by two lecherous older men who try to blackmail her into satisfying their desire. In the hands of male painters, it had been an erotic subject, but not in Artemisia's version.
It's shown very much from the perspective of a young woman who's victimized. That is, we're meant to sympathize with her, not with the elders. This is a very bold move for a young woman, especially at 17 years old, to paint a subject that is so forcefully nude.
But this is one of the most convincing female breasts in the history of art. We see a breast that is pendant. It is natural. There are sort of crow's feet at the wrinkles of the arms, under the arms. It's produced from the study of a body that one knows from the inside as well as from the outside.
With this painting, Artemisia had made her mark. She had shown that she could eclipse her father. In 1611, Orazio Gentileschi made a new friend, one whose influence he hoped would help him access the level of patronage he craved.
Orazio worked constantly, but he was not getting important commissions until he met Agostino Tassi. It was Agostino Tassi who introduced him to the papal court. Scipione Borghese, Pope Paul V, had no interest whatsoever in Orazio before his meeting with Agostino.
Prima del suo incontro con Agostino.
But Tassi was to change more than Artemisia Gentileschi's fortunes.
Ma voi dipingete, quindi?
Sì, dipingo. Però ho problemi con la prospettiva.
Con la prospettiva? Ma io sono il principe della prospettiva. Vostro padre lo sa.
Elle est bonne, elle est vraiment.
She's very good. But Orazio cannot teach her perspective and drawing. And so he had in his back pocket a man with the strongest drawing skills in Rome. He tells him, why not give my daughter some lessons?
There's really nothing sympathetic about this character. You can say unambiguously was a nasty criminal and all sorts of crimes attributed to him, including other rapes. So it also makes you question Orazio's judgment, I think, that he would spend time with someone like this and also that he would hire him to teach his daughter perspective. I have a daughter. I would not hire Agostino Tassi to teach her anything.
We really have to wonder if it was a terrible mistake for Orazio Gentileschi to bring Agostino Tassi so closely into his orbit. There are some thoughts, perhaps, that Agostino Tassi was intended by Orazio all along as possibly a husband for Artemisia.
Agostino Tassi quickly became infatuated with Artemisia and made his passion known to all of Rome. On the 6th of May, 1611, Artemisia found out the hard way just what Tassi was capable of.
È stato terribile. Mi ha presa con forza. Oh! Per me era la prima volta. Ho sentito un bruciore improvviso, lacerante. Ho fatto di tutto per tenerlo lontano da me. Gli ho graffiato il volto, gli ho strappato i capelli. Gli ho dato morsi, calci, schiaffi. Ma non è servito a niente. Continuava a penetrarmi. A un certo punto ho tirato fuori tutte le mie forze, gli ho strappato brandelli di carne. Ma lui continuava. Quando ho finito sono riuscita ad afferrare un coltello. L'ho guardato. L'ho minacciato, gli ho detto, tu mi hai disonorata. Pagherai per questo.
Bella Artemisia.
Ancora voi, qui. Lasciatemi sola, vi prego.
Mai. Voi mi appartenete.
Mio padre potrebbe tornare da un momento all'altro, vi prego.
Artemisia was in an impossible situation. The honor of herself and her family were now compromised. Her only way out was to marry Tassi. This he promised her, but only if she allowed him back into her bed.
State tranquilla, vi sposo. Ho alcune beghe da risolvere.
Every time he sleeps with her, he tells her, now you are mine, and you have to do what I tell you, because if you don't, I won't marry you.
We also have to think about this in the 17th century context, that rape really meant something different than it does today. At the time, it was seen again as a crime against the honor of the family, and it was something that could be remedied, as terrible as it sounds to think of, by marrying the rapist. Artemisia seems to have accepted this, that if she would continue to be Tassi's lover, to marry him eventually, as he promised, that would be a perfectly acceptable scenario.
And so Artemisia acquiesced. What she did not know was that Tassi could not deliver on his promise. The relationship between Artemisia and Agostino Tassi continued for almost a year before her father found out. It was everything he most feared. A daughter dishonored, her marriage prospects dashed, his family ruined, and all under his own roof.
Artemisia, Artemisia, dimmi, è vero quello che dicono? Eh? Lo voglio sentire con la tua voce, è
sì,
vero?
Sì, è vero, padre, è vero.
And has to take action to defend the family honor, not only because of the assault on Artemisia's body, but because of the assault on the Gentileschi household's ability to carry on its professional life.
Tu ti rendi conto? Ti rendi conto che la nostra famiglia così è rovinata? Ma come è potuto succedere? Me lo dici?
Everybody's laughing in Rome. Everyone knows that Agostino is Artemisia's lover, that Orazio is being made a fool of.
Ma come è potuto succedere? Me lo dici?
Non è colpa mia, padre.
E di chi è colpa? Voglio sentirlo.
Lui mi ha promesso che mi avrebbe sposata.
E tu ci hai creduto?
A furious Orazio sought redress through the courts, not for rape, but because his daughter had been deflowered, dishonoring him and lowering her value as a bride.
Ti rendi conto che la nostra famiglia era una famiglia onorevole? E adesso non possiamo più nulla.
Se uno guarda. Two things become evident when you examine the legislation on rape in the 17th century. The first one is that the crime is not the rape only, but the rape of a virgin. If Artemisia was not a virgin, there would be no crime. Nobody would care that she had been raped if she was not a virgin. All your problems go away if you then marry the girl you have raped. In any case, you can't be prosecuted. If you pay a dowry for the girl you have raped so that she can marry someone else, then it's not a big problem.
Non ci sono grandi problemi.
It's strange to think of and quite disgusting to think of today, but that the value of a daughter was based on her virginity being intact and that the loss of that was a financial loss to the family.
The court case was brutal and lasted 7 long months. To win, Tassi needed to convince the judges that Artemisia had not been a virgin when he met her. He went further, claiming that he had only been the latest of her lovers. For Artemisia, the hurt and humiliation were complete.
Intorno a Artemisia.
He weaves a web of lies around Artemisia, which he seems to be able to support because he apparently bribes witnesses.
Corrompe testimoni, presumibilmente.
Si faccia entrare la Gentileschi.
Artemisia then accepted. There was only one way to redeem her reputation.
Procediamo. Artemisia Gentileschi. Sei disposta a ripetere qui, davanti a noi, sotto tortura, quello che hai dichiarato?
Sì.
Procediamo. Prendete nota.
Testimony under torture was deemed by the courts to be truthful. Artemisia risked her painter's hands in the vicious grip of the thumbscrews.
Dunque?
Ai. È tutto vero, lo giuro, è tutto vero quello che ho confessato. Ai. Basta.
Si registra. La Gentileschi conferma.
Artemisia has no hesitation in telling what happened, not even a moment's hesitation in admitting her emotional involvement with Agostino Tassi.
But no amount of pressure could force Tassi to marry Artemisia.
What they're all going to discover is that, in fact, Tassi has been paid off by his wife's lover to go away and that he is still married.
It then emerged that Tassi had married his wife only after raping her. He was sentenced to exile, but his highly placed connections ensured that he never served his sentence. A hastily arranged marriage allowed Artemisia to escape the gossip of Rome.
Artemisia married the brother of the lawyer who helped her father during the trial. She gets married to be able to move freely, to leave her father's house.
The impact of the trial was twofold. On the one hand, her reputation was forever tarnished. On the other hand, it shone a bright spotlight on her, and because she was extraordinarily gifted and extraordinarily beautiful, of course it attracted the attention of collectors.
Although Artemisia's husband had few resources, he was her passport to a new life in Florence, away from her painful past with her father.
He tries very hard to stay in touch with her. He tries to go back to Florence. Only the ambassador in Rome says he's an unpleasant person who should not come to Florence and that he doesn't know how to paint very well and he can't bring anything that the local painters don't have.
But Orazio did leave Artemisia with a gift. He introduced her to the Medici court.
E femmina come è piaciuto a Dio. Avendola drizzata alla professione della pittura, in 3 anni si è talmente appraticata che posso osare dire che oggi non ce ne sia un'altra pari a lei. Ha già dipinto opere che i principali maestri di quest'arte non arrivano forse a pareggiare.
I think the move to Florence, where at court women were very important. We think about Christina of Lorraine. We also think about Maria Maddalena of Austria, really powerful women at court. And I think that just being in Florence helped to emancipate Artemisia.
In no time, Artemisia was absorbing everything Florence had to offer, teaching herself everything she had missed.
There's a great deal of interest in theater, in music, in science, in all forms of literary activity. And I think Artemisia found her way into all of those cultural areas. We see her portrayed playing a musical instrument. So I think she had so many talents and so many interests. And in Florence, she was able to discover how well she could perform in all of these areas, which would have been very, very difficult for her in Rome.
She has this extraordinary power, both in her art and in her life, to turn this tragedy into something else. She uses it to elevate herself, to move forward, to learn from, and then to paint.
Cosimo II de' Medici was an avid collector and patron. He was fascinated by Artemisia's work.
At that time, Cosimo de' Medici wanted Caravaggio. And this young woman knew how to paint like Caravaggio.
and she produced a spectacular Caravaggio.
Beyond the homage to Caravaggio, it is hard not to see Artemisia's rage in this painting. In fact, it is thought that she had painted an early version during the 7 months of her trial.
Well, there's an autobiographical element in every artist's painting. For me, the difference is that she turned that into something larger than her own personal experience.
Artemisia's version of the story of Judith beheading Holofernes is certainly visceral.
She one-ups him, totally one-ups Caravaggio. She says, I'll show you what it's like to decapitate a body. You don't do it squeamishly. You do it with gusto, you do it with strength.
Caravaggio, for all of his naturalism, he doesn't do compelling movement. So the blood squirting out of Caravaggio's neck of Holofernes, it looks like pieces of red string sticking out. What Artemisia could do is to imagine sort of the spurting blood, the rivulets of blood, things you can't get to freeze in time, but you have to use the imagination and understand how action works and how to portray it in paint. Artemisia was particularly successful at portraying violence compellingly.
Artemisia was to revisit Judith's story again and again. She became renowned for her compelling portraits of strong biblical and historical women, painted with stark intensity and uncompromising realism.
Artemisia gained from her sometimes unfortunate experiences the creative raw material from life on which she built to create those characters. Every artist is in the work that he or she paints. And the most convincing characters of narrative art are those that the artist is in some way identified with. So, of course, she's in these figures, and her experience has gone into the creation of those characters.
Whether anger from her early life was the driving force of her art is debatable, but there is evidence that she had become a forceful, sometimes aggressive adult. Grown into a formidable woman, she could even be capable of violence herself.
Artemisia paints violent images, but she is herself a violent woman. One of her servants complained that after he asked to be paid, she and her husband attacked him and threatened to kill him if he resubmitted his demands. So there is an inherent violence in Artemisia.
Maestro Galilei, ci informi sui vostri ultimi studi. Siamo curiosi.
By 1617, Artemisia's transformation was complete. She had forged powerful friendships with figures such as Galileo and Buonarroti, and her work was much in demand. Her income supported her four children, and indeed her husband, who had become her agent.
She can't do anything without him because at that time a woman belongs to her husband. She can't sign contracts. She can't buy her colors. He becomes the one who negotiates the contracts and collects their payments.
He left her a certain amount of freedom, on the condition, of course, that she worked. Because he was living off her income.
But her crowning achievement came when she was invited to join the illustrious Accademia del Disegno, the first woman ever to be so honored. It gained her more than prestige.
This membership gives her some form of legal equality. Now, she can sign her own contracts. She can buy her own colors. She can have a passport. And she can travel. She's equal to a man from then on.
But financial difficulties were never far away. No matter how successful Artemisia was, there was never enough money, and the debts piled up.
This is a woman who's trying to make money painting all the time. And she's producing a child almost every year. And some of the most sort of anguishing notes we have from her concern the need for money at the time when she's giving birth. So the marriage might have been fine, but she was still having to deal with all of the demands of family life in addition to being a professional woman.
By 1619, Artemisia's problems had increased. One of her key patrons, Cosimo II, was dying of tuberculosis. Meanwhile, she was growing frustrated with her work.
Artemisia felt quite confined. The commissions were always the same. The contracts were still the same. She had little time to paint other pictures, and she had accumulated many debts.
When Artemisia lost two of her children, life in Florence became unbearable. Leaving behind the town where she had achieved such success, she decided on another challenge. She returned to Rome.
Le molte malattie minori che ho sofferto, così come le preoccupazioni non irrilevanti che ho avuto con la mia casa e la mia famiglia, mi hanno spinto a questa decisione.
Elle a été humiliée.
She was humiliated in Rome. She was dragged through the mud. Now she's Artemisia Gentileschi. She needs to return, to resume her life in the city where she grew up. I think she needed to exist again in Rome and not to exist as a woman covered in shame, but as a great painter.
But Artemisia's return began badly. Her father's welcome was distinctly icy.
He was not at all happy to see her return. There were scenes, terrible scenes, that lasted weeks. Because she had returned without his permission, because she had left Florence without bringing her inventory, because she had arrived without money, and because she was an embarrassment, as inconvenient as she had been when she left.
The situation only ended when her husband took a stand.
Basta, questo è troppo.
Dovevo arrivare a questo punto per conoscere davvero mio marito. Ora tutti gli aspetti della mia vita vanno bene. Ho avuto già molte commesse. La mia casa di Roma è bellissima ed è in ordine.
But the marriage was floundering. It didn't survive much longer.
They have a complicated relationship. She really has a lot of affection for him because he saved her. But nevertheless, she surpasses him. He's increasingly left behind in the shadows. Even though she's grateful, she may not have a lot of regard left for him.
Also, Artemisia had discovered the consolation of an extramarital affair.
Voi dite che non conoscete altra donna al di fuori di me e della vostra mano destra. Come invidio la vostra mano destra, perché possiede tutto ciò che io non posseggo. Sarò vostra schiava fedele, devota, finché avrò fiato in corpo.
Rumors abounded, many of them probably untrue, but there is little doubt that after a shaky start, Artemisia took Rome by storm.
She's in Rome at a time where talent opens all the doors, so she's increasingly sought after and enters into other universes. She's seen with ambassadors, other painters.
Although she continued to paint strong biblical heroines, Artemisia began to turn her attention to another kind of figure, equally as inspiring, historical characters such as Cleopatra.
Yes, but what are other painters doing? That's what men paint, and from the moment that Artemisia has defined herself as a painter, period, and not as a woman artist, she paints the same subjects as men.
But Artemisia interpreted her subjects in her own unique way. For instance, in her portrait of Lucretia, a Roman heroine who committed suicide rather than shame her family after she was raped.
She radically rethinks every one of those female biblical heroes or literary heroes. Lucretia, for example. Think about it from Artemisia's point of view. Here's Lucretia. What a depressing subject. She kills herself, and that's that. Well, she does. She said, I won't present her doing that. I will present her before she decided to do that. I will make the decision the subject of the picture.
What is also striking about Artemisia's work then is the way she paints her female nudes. Those she paints in Rome seem more sensuous, more relaxed, suggesting perhaps that Artemisia was for once happy.
She is often using her body as a model, though it may not literally be her that she's portraying. Though one gets a sense that a woman painted this picture of a nude woman was something that people were very much aware of. So it's never stated overtly that this is a self-portrait. Certainly, I think people at the time were aware of how unusual it was, really, for a woman to be painting pictures of this type.
Now a single working mother, Artemisia uses everything she has learned to further her career in Rome.
Artemisia transforms herself from an artist of great talent but little culture into a skilled artist with sophisticated techniques that she learns in Florence. She deals with clients, dukes, grand dukes, with great ease.
She had already obtained commissions from cardinals and princes. The Duke of Bavaria promised her an enormous salary if she went to Munich. She is getting paid her weight in gold.
Avrebbe pagata a prezzo di carbone. But despite all Artemisia's success, the big lucrative public commission still eluded her. They all went to her male rivals.
At that time, important painters would paint altars for St. Peter's. Nobody offered Artemisia to paint an altar, let alone one in St. Peter's.
The idea that men paint with their penises, which we sort of pick up in the rhetoric around Jackson Pollock or Picasso, that was already present in the Renaissance. There was an assumption that only males were capable of creative invention, that women could at best be copyists, and so the sort of stereotype was that the woman artist was given a chance to do the inferior genres, such as still life painting, or even portraiture was considered to be inferior to history painting or large-scale religious paintings.
Disillusioned, Artemisia decided to try Venice, but there are very few records of her paintings there. In 1629, she moved on again, choosing Naples. Controlled by Spain, it was then a city known to cherish its artists, of whom there were many.
The art market is sensational in Naples. Naples is Spanish, and it has all these viceroys who in very little time build themselves incredible collections, because the idea is to bring those back to Spain, because the king of Spain is one of the greatest art collectors of all time.
She arrives there like a queen, like a master. And she forms a school, a sort of Artemisia Gentileschi Academy, where she trains other painters.
There just weren't enough hours in the day. Artemisia called upon her brothers to help deal with her business affairs, hoping this would give her more time to paint.
Siamo stati fermati dalla nieve. E ora dobbiamo informare nostro padre.
Voi, Giulia? Cosa mi dite di nostro padre?
Vive a Londra. Pensate che consiglia Carlo I sulle tele da acquistare. E voi?
Her brothers are scoundrels. They are men who are going to try and exploit her.
Recentemente il duca di Ghisa ha dato a mio fratello 200 piastre in pagamento di un mio quadro che mio fratello gli aveva portato. Ma non ho mai ricevuto il compenso perché mio fratello ha dovuto andare altrove.
She badly needed help. Quite apart from her scheming brothers, she had the crowds of ambitious, unscrupulous artists of Naples to contend with. They were all jostling for position, and it was far from genteel. She was unprepared for the lengths to which they were prepared to go.
The competition in Naples is ferocious. How painters there deal with each other is terrifying. When they are rivals, they sew off the legs of their scaffoldings, they put acid in their colors, they take each other to court, they get into knife fights.
Artemisia was not to be intimidated. She took matters into her own hands.
Supplico la signoria vostra di scrivere al nunzio qui a Napoli, nella forma più appropriata, per ottenere la licenza di portare armi per il chierico che rende servizi e agisce nell'interesse della mia famiglia. E pertanto apprezzerei molto un tale favore. Vi mostrerò di cosa è capace una donna che ha nel cuore l'animo di Cesare.
Naples brought another challenge, another battle. There was still demand for Artemisia's themes, her stories of abused or heroic women. But the fashion for her Caravaggio-style treatment was beginning to wane.
She doesn't remain on her Caravaggesque chord. She has other chords she can play. And the fascinating thing about Artemisia is that she is elusive, unpredictable. She has many ways in which she can express herself.
Artemisia, head of her own household, of her own school, and of her own affairs, finally got what she always craved, public commissions.
It gives her what she so desperately wanted, absolute exposure. It is a way to be recognized and exhibited forever. So it's true that it was absolutely necessary for Artemisia to get this status because it was under constant threat.
Now Naples was at her feet. Once more, she had triumphed against all the odds.
I've come across many, many elaborate, flattering poems about her by poets that were at the very upper echelons of society. And I can just give you some example. Who was the creator, the gracious giver of your brush, if not the winged god, Love? He made you that tool so that your merit is known to the world. He shall make you a canvas from his blindfold.
Artemisia was not one to rest upon her laurels. With Naples conquered, she looked around for her next challenge. But Artemisia was still driven by financial need. Now she had not one, but two daughters, one just 3 years old from an unknown father.
She has an extremely strong and courageous personality. Having an illegitimate child was normally a scandal, and women did not raise their illegitimate children themselves. They brought them to the nuns. Artemisia, for her part, does not even hesitate and raises her daughter herself.
By 1637, Artemisia had saved enough for her eldest daughter's dowry. That year, she received an invitation from Charles I of England to come to London. It offered her the chance to earn the dowry for her younger daughter, with the added frisson that she would once again meet up with her father, who had already moved to the English court.
The King of England has been trying to have her come to court for a very long time. He had been trying to bring artists to work at his court, but very few Italians wanted to brave the English fog. They must have offered her a ton of money.
Ma che piacere vedere.
Piacere mio, padre.
Come mai da questa parte?
Per vedere come state. E per mostrarvi il mio ultimo lavoro.
Fatemi vedere.
You know, her father was not well liked there, and he got a few commissions, but mostly resented by the local painters.
Accidenti, Artemisia, siete diventata una pittrice straordinaria.
È di vostro gradimento.
È superiore ad ogni aspettativa.
He is the master, and she is the student. What's more, she is a daughter, and he is an old man who is also her father. This is a reunion that evokes their beginning. For him, she is still the daughter who works for him, even though he is fully aware of her talent. But it is a talent that needs to work for him.
Orazio Gentileschi had been commissioned to paint the ceiling of Queen Henrietta's house in Greenwich, a huge job for what was now an elderly man.
And I think it's pretty clear that one main reason was that she was going there to support her father in his major commissions.
Artemisia would have immediately realized that her father would not be able to complete the ceiling alone. They worked together, possibly equals at last.
In fact, even today, it is really hard to determine who painted which figure when she helps finish painting the ceiling of Greenwich House.
Twenty years after their last encounter, Artemisia may have reconciled the relationship that had troubled her all her life. But it was not to be for long. In 1639, Orazio Gentileschi died suddenly. After Orazio's death, Artemisia returned to Naples, where her youngest daughter was to be married. But the magic seemed to have gone. Artemisia had lost the fire that had driven her for so long. By 1650, she was once again struggling to earn a living.
Desidero esprimerle la mia gratitudine per la pena che si è dato nel cercare di procurarmi delle commesse, che sono molto rare in questi tempi magri. La prego, per l'amor di Dio, non abbassate il prezzo che ho indicato. Per prendermi cura di un mio assillo, è necessario che Vostra Signoria Illustrissima mi anticipi 100 ducati.
She has less and less commissions. In fact, she says, if I were a man, you would not treat me like this. It is really the tragic end of an aging artist whose fading glory is just not enough to earn her a living.
But Artemisia never stopped painting. This, her last known work, is a return to her beginnings.
It was really the experience of being female, more than the rape per se, I think, that was a constantly shaping influence on her art. The art she made spoke to the experience of other women in that society.
Artemisia is thought to have died in the 1656 plague in Naples, but no one knows for certain. She would have been 63 years old.
I think she knew one thing. She knew that she was a great painter, because art is the essence of Artemisia.
Artemisia Gentileschi disappeared from history until the 20th century, when she was reinstated in the position to which she had so bravely fought her way, the First Lady of Baroque painting.
Her victory is that her painting is appreciated, that her painting is finally understood, rediscovered in the private collections, on the art markets, finally recognized.